This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takacs, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Are you ready to enhance your team management skills in 2024? Join us for an exclusive webinar featuring the father of dental podcasting, Gary Takacs, along with digital marketing expert Naren Araraja on the 5th of March 2024. Submit your burning questions on hiring and retaining team members at thrivingdentist.com/askgary and dive into a session filled with practical solutions and essential marketing tips. Don't miss out on this opportunity to scale up your team dynamics. Sign up now at thrivingdentist.com/askgary. We look forward to seeing you there.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takacs, your podcast co-host. We have a great episode for you today, especially timely. This episode is titled Hiring Quality Team Members from Outside of Dentistry. Well, I'm going to share some thoughts and some ideas that if you have an open position or openings in your practice, about why we might want to look outside of dentistry from filling those successfully. Excited to share some information and some success stories with you that might be a pathway to finding a really good team. But before I get into that, a couple announcements to make. First announcement is our next webinar coming up is titled 7 Steps for a Remarkable New Patient Experience. That webinar is happening on March 12th. I'm going to go through these 7 steps, and we know how important it is to make a great first impression on our patients. And that webinar is all about how to go through some specific steps so that that patient develops an incredible first impression of your practice and wants to be a patient for life in your practice. Come join us, 8 p.m. Eastern time. It's 1 hour. So if I do the time translation, that's 5 p.m. Pacific time, 8 p.m. Eastern time, 1 hour. Come join us. There is no cost. We're providing your tuition as a courtesy for being a listener of the Thriving Dentist Show. Go to thrivingdentist.com/webinar and register. You have to register, but be sure to register for that one. And I think you'll get a lot out of it. The next announcement I have is we have a returning guest, one of my favorite guests to have on the Thriving Dentist Show, Dr. Mo Budak. And Mo is going to continue with his History of Dentistry series. This is episode 6 on the History of Dentistry series with Dr. Mo Budak. You're going to enjoy this. Here we go.
Hello, folks. This is Dr. Mo Budak here presenting the History of Dentistry in 5 minutes. We're on to episode 6, where we continue into the modern era. When we last left off, we learned about Waterloo teeth. During the Battle of Waterloo in the Napoleonic Wars of 1815, 51,000 men died. Waterloo teeth, as they were known, referred to any teeth stolen from the mouths of dead soldiers. Body snatchers followed armies into battle and returned home with barrels full of teeth, which were then sold to dentists to be used in dentures to make them look natural. The year 1839 is considered to be the birth year of organized dentistry and of educational reform. In that year, Dr. Chapin Harris and Dr. Horace Hayden authored the text, The Dental Art, Practical Treatise on Dental Surgery. In that same year, the first dental journal called the American Journal of Dental Science was published, also edited by Dr. Harris. And the pioneering organization, the American Society of Dental Surgeons, was established, headed by Dr. Hayden.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Coaching in Action segment. Today, we had an awesome contributor, Dr. Budak, and Gary also talked about the 7 steps for a remarkable new patient experience. Once again, thank you, Dr. Budak. And please don't forget to check out thrivingdentist.com/webinar to learn about the 7 steps for a remarkable new patient experience, 12th of March, 8 to 9 p.m. Eastern time. The topic we're going to dive into today is hiring quality team members from outside of dentistry. Hiring quality team members from outside of dentistry. And working very closely with Gary, Gary and I share a lot of mutual clients. You know, a lot of Gary's clients have us do marketing and vice versa. One of the things I'm noticing is, and Gary, you can correct me if I'm wrong when you're sharing your comments, hiring has become a challenge hiring people the way you used to hire is not working anymore. So sometimes you have to mix things up. Sometimes you have to change the way you do things. And you specifically, Gary, and you've done this with your own experience at LifeSmiles, plus with a lot of your clients, you have encouraged your clients to hire from outside of dentistry. And it has provided amazing results for you. So I think getting into this topic of like, how do we do it? How do we do it right? I think it's a really good use of our time today. So let's jump right in.
Well, Niren, I think there's a silver lining in the cloud. The cloud, and I think we have to recognize it, we'd be foolish not to recognize it, is that hiring in dentistry is not like it's ever been in the past.
Right.
There is a much more supply, meaning jobs that are available in dentistry, than people that want those jobs. The supply and demand is totally tilted in the favor of the applicant. And that's a relatively new phenomenon. Those of us that have been in this profession for a long time will remember a time. I started in 1980. My goodness, 44 years ago. I remember a time where you could put an ad out, and you could have 10 quality resumes. Within a matter of hours. And then it's a matter of, boy, I've got to narrow this down because they all look good. And Today there are postings that go unanswered, not a single resume. It's just a different hiring client. And to be fair, this isn't just dental specific.
Agreed.
This is in any, quite literally any profession, any industry. Therese and I enjoy supporting local restaurants. And as a result of that, we have a lot of friends who are restaurant owners, and we enjoy supporting them. Restaurant business is not an easy business.
Right.
And Niren, not a single one of our friends is completely staffed. Right. There are openings in the restaurants.
Yeah. I remember going to Florida not too long ago, and literally they said, you have to wait 20 minutes. And there's all these empty seats. Why? Because we don't have enough staff.
Right.
So they won't even seat you for 20 minutes because they don't have enough people.
So I wanted to make that comment because I hope that, you know, the dental listeners here don't get an inferiority complex like it's just us. Is it just us? Is it just dentistry? No, not at all. The silver lining, though, is that in many ways, the way we've always searched for team members is a bit of a hit or miss. And maybe now if we start looking at it through a more creative way, maybe a much more intentional way of hiring, it's going to end up with finding the right fit. What we want is when someone that we've interviewed is thinking, I have just found my job home. This is where I want to spend the rest of my life, my work life, contributing at work. And then we all want that on our side. We want to say, I found my ideal team member that fits our team. You know, we have 7 goals for a thriving practice. And one of those goals, goal number 4, this is for all of our clients in my coaching work. We have individual goals that we define, you know, based on their own individual needs and direction and what they're doing. But we have 7. And goal number 4 is a high-performance team that I truly love and enjoy working with. Goal number 4. And when I go through the 7 goals with my clients, I ask the question, which one do you think is most important? And by the way, I say there's no wrong answers because you could argue, I could be like the debate coach, you know, on the debate team in college, and I could argue where each one of these is most important. But I then say, I'll go ahead and go first. You think about it, but I'll go first. I happen to think that goal number 4 is most important. The high performance team you truly love and enjoy working with. Because I believe if we don't have number 4, you're not going to get the other 6. You're not going to get them. And so I think that is critical. So the idea of intentional hiring, and I would say many practices over the last years have gotten away from intentional hiring and instead have hired someone with a pulse. They were so desperate. They hired out of desperation. Well, I'm not thrilled about so-and-so, but I need someone. And that usually ends up in disappointment and usually ends up not being the right fit, usually ends up taking the practice down the wrong direction. So I think the silver lining is it gives us a chance to be way more intentional about what. Now, there's a certain amount of credentialing with some positions. If we're hiring a hygienist, that person has to be licensed. You know, they can't do on-the-job hygiene training, right? But even there, Naren, I'll share a trend that is there's a severe shortage right now of hygienists. That is going to start to change coming up later this spring. There is a movement. It's a fairly significant movement of nurses. These are mid and even early late career nurses that have made a conscious decision to change careers. And they're leaving nursing.
Yeah.
They're leaving nursing because primarily a number of reasons, but primarily some nursing positions require 24-hour shifts. You know, you work crazy hours. A second reason is a lot of nursing has gotten away from care and gotten into more paper pushing. And third, they end up working for these huge corporations that own all the hospitals and own all the big managed care medical facilities.
So less medicine.
Less medicine and it's more business.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of mid and late career nurses that have said, you know what? I'm going to put my my career on hold for 2 years.
Yeah.
I'm going to go get my education. I'm going to get my vocational degree in hygiene. And I'm going to spend the rest of my career being a hygienist. And there, that's a big group. In fact, the ADA got wind of this, and the ADA tried to see if there was a way to accelerate the training because these were all, you know, healthcare background people. So is there a way we could do less than a 2-year training so we could, there's a need for them right now that we could kind of move them through the training pipeline much quicker so we can get them in the workforce? And the answer was no, because of the practical part of their training. The practical part of the training is with patients. And they didn't want to cut that out because that would make them a less qualified new hygienist. Exactly. So they said, no, unfortunately, you're going to have to go. They're going to have to go through the whole 2 years. But now the first group of those is going to be graduating this May, coming up literally like in, what is that, about 3 months from when this episode comes out. So even though that, you know, you can't just hire someone that thinks they might want to be a hygienist without any credentialing. They have to have a degree and they have to be licensed. But even there, it's starting to change. I'll tell you what, if you have coming May, if you have any new hygienists that are playing that used to be nurses, I would put them at the top of the list. Because I personally think these people made conscious decisions because they wanted to be part of personalized healthcare. They want to be a deliverer of healthcare. They love patients. They want to interact with patients. I would put them, now that's not saying they'll all be equal. You know, it'll vary. But I would put them at the top of the list. Because they have made an intentional decision to be in your career. And I think you might find, and these hygienists might be in their mid-40s, late 40s, early 50s, and they want to spend the rest of their career finding an awesome office like yours to really focus on direct patient care. But now let's pivot to the other positions. Any administrative position we can hire from outside of dentistry. Any of the administrative, even office manager.
Yes.
We could hire our new patient coordinator. That's a role you have in your practice. That person can come from outside of dentistry. As in fact, actually, very few new patient coordinators exist in dentistry. Most offices haven't used that role. So it's likely that someone we have, we're going to hire from outside of dentistry. And even assistants. Again, it depends on your state. You have to look at your qualifications. In most cases, they don't have to be licensed RDA, registered dental assistant. They can be vocational. And in fact, many vocational assisting schools, they have, you know, the 11-week vocational assisting school is enough for them to be able to join your practice as an assistant. And then there's many examples in many states, they can be on the job trained and then they can get their credentialing as they go. Like they could become x-ray certified so that now they're credentialed to be able to provide x-rays. But I would like to kind of just tune you in to maybe some types of people, some jobs that they might want to pivot to. You know, Naren, one thing that happened with COVID and the way the world shut down after COVID is it gave a lot of people time to think about how they want to spend their time.
Their lives.
And their life. And many dentists, this happened to many dentists, it gave you a chance to rethink about, hey, do I really want to, you know, feel like I'm a hamster on a treadmill handing fat cats at the insurance company $500,000 a year anymore? Do I want to do that? Right. Or do I want to pursue my passion. And there's people have done that. People have looked at that in their career. Do I really want to do what I'm doing where I feel like every day, you know, I'm off to the salt mine. You know, I'm doing my time. I'm doing my set work.
That's the silver lining, right? And I think you're right. So this is not just happening in dentistry. So if you just put an ad today on a, you know, the usual way you did 5 years ago, like you said, you'll get crickets. And even the people who book the appointment for an appointment, 1 out of 3 will show up. At least I've heard those stories from dentists. Like they don't even show up. They don't even let you know they're not coming for the interview. So you have to look outside of your pond. Do you have to look outside?
So let's talk about where to look. Yeah. Think of yourself as a consumer, doctor. When you're out as a consumer, maybe you're renting a car, maybe you're at a restaurant, maybe you are visiting a hotel. Anybody in frontline customer service that does their job well, think of a server at a restaurant. And if that server does their job well, here's what I would encourage you to do. I would ask their name. Sometimes they have a name tag on. If not, oftentimes they give their name at the beginning of the meal. Hi, I'm Susan. I'll be taking care of you tonight. You don't remember their name? And if they delivered top-notch service at the end of the meal, say, you know, Susan, I want to compliment you. You did an incredible job. You were attentive. You answered great questions about what was on the menu. I love what you recommended. I took your recommendation. It was fabulous. If you're ever thinking about changing careers, I own a dental practice nearby. Here's my business card. Please feel welcome to reach out to me. We're always looking for brilliant people like you. And at the very least, what happens there, Aaron, is now there's someone locally that knows about your dental office. Maybe she's perfectly happy working in a restaurant. But, you know, one of the problems of a restaurant is long hours, late nights. And, you know, if she's a mom, those late night hours don't always mesh with family. Often weekend work. Now you can offer very favorable hours, typically no weekends.
No weekends, evenings. Yeah,
very favorable. And frankly, they'll be getting a raise.
A reliable paycheck, right? Like every single month, as opposed to, well, sometimes you're busy, sometimes you have to fill in for somebody else. It's just a mess.
Right. Yeah. So anytime you're a recipient of good customer service, practice your people skills and just strike up a conversation.
Even a retail shop, right?
Like let's say same thing. Retail, you know, there's a lot of people in retail that realize that that the future of retail is gone. New shops aren't opening up. Everything's going to be done online. And those jobs are drying up. So retail's another good place to look. Banking is another good place. Banking is great because banking is one of those things where, again, everything's going online. People that used to work their way up from a teller, you know, up to eventually become an officer in the bank, those days are kind of gone because it's being done online. Another example is school teachers. School teachers, and I'm pretty firmly convinced that about half the school teachers in the world are so frustrated about the school district politics, they want to change careers.
Yes.
They want to change. And school teachers can make great new patient coordinators, can make great administrative team members. They learn quickly. They're fantastic. They don't have to know anything about dentistry. Counselors, another good example. You know, people are working in counseling. There's been a lot of discussion of mental health. You know, that's been kind of on the radar screen over the last couple of years, and rightfully so. I'm kind of happy about the recognition of mental health as, you know, something we need to pay attention to. But if you've noticed, Naren, there are a lot of counseling firms offering virtual counseling services. So doing this from home, right? As opposed to, you used to go to a counselor, you know, and sit down in their office and talk to them. And now they're just doing it virtually. And there's a lot of counselors saying, I don't like that. I want to be face-to-face. I want to be with people. So there's another area, you know, that you might look at. But I really think that any of these, anywhere that someone gets an opportunity to exercise their people skills could be a really good fit for dentistry. Very likely, every one of the possibilities that I've named today will have some computer experience. You know, you think about the point of sale in a restaurant, you know, it's not a cash register anymore. It's a computerized point of sale. If they can run their POS software in the restaurant, they can run Open Dental, Dentrix, EagleSoft. Absolutely. They can learn how to do that.
Let me ask you a question, Gary. I think you said the reason a lot of practices are not successful is they haven't changed the way they look for these patients. And you gave me one way, which is
their team members.
It's a team members, right? You gave me one way, which is look at the people you meet on a day-to-day basis. What about hiring itself? Like, you know, because I know a lot of job descriptions say, so you must have 17 years of experience in, you know what I mean? They're looking for the wrong kind of people. And of course, those wrong kind of people are not interested in working for you, unfortunately.
Yeah, more of the burned out wrong kind of people.
Yeah.
But what about an ad? Could be an Indeed ad where it's said in the Indeed ad, if you are currently a server at a restaurant, a school mm-hmm. teacher, if you are working in retail, if you're working in banking and are interested in changing careers, we would love to talk to you. That's a intriguing point to have in your ad, because you know what? There may be a school teacher going through there and read that and said, oh my God, they're speaking to me. That ad is speaking to me. So if you're currently working in, and go ahead and fill in the blanks, or whatever you think. Is something
even the title of the ad, right? So instead of saying dental this, just make it a little bit generic so it attracts others who are not just only looking for dental, you know. Now all of a sudden, oh, it has all the things I'm looking for, working with patients, taking care of patients.
Right.
I can see myself doing this. I love helping people. I feel like I'm working like you said, a nurse, you know, I feel like I'm working in this, you know, soulless 10,000 person corporation, and I want to be feel like I'm making a difference.
Right.
You can start attracting those people.
Yeah, well, that's the other, you raised another point. What about the big corporations where you're one of 100,000?
Right.
You really want to be, you know, that little tiny grain of sand on the beach. And that could be another, you know, another source. If you're in an area that has the mega employers, is that, you know, where they want to work? And here's what I would do. If there's any interest at all, invite that person to come into your office, and not as a working interview. This is not a working interview. I want to emphasize this. This is to simply hang out and observe and see whether this might be in your future. This might be in your future. You know, I did that 11 years ago. I successfully hired a young lady. There was a waitress in a restaurant. And I said to her, just impeccable service. The water glass was topped off. She could answer any questions about the menu. She was attentive without being overly attentive. Does that make sense, Naren?
Yeah.
As a server, kind of server that you want to leave a big tip. And she had a name tag on. Her name was Carly. And I said, Carly, I want to compliment you. You do your job really well. If I own a dental practice nearby, if you ever are thinking about changing careers, here's where you can reach me. This actually is my personal cell number. You're welcome to reach out to me anytime. And thank you for such a high level of service tonight. She looked at me and said, oh, well, thanks. And a week later, she called me. And Gary, I don't know if you remember me. I said, of course I remember you, Carly. So were you serious? I said, absolutely. She goes, but I have no dental experience. None. Well, no, not quite. I've been a patient. But I've never had any cavities. I think I've had my, you know, I go in for my hygiene appointments and I've had my teeth whitened, but I don't know anything about dentistry. I said, perfect. She said, no, really. I don't know anything about dentistry. I said, that really is perfect for us because we can train you to be our ideal. All the skills you have in customer service will fit our practice like a glove. We can train you for that. And I asked her, I said, do you have days off? She said, yeah, I have 2 days off during the week. I said, you're welcome to come in and just shadow, just hang out. We'll pay you. We'll pay you for that, for your time. And see, and maybe it'll be for you, maybe not. Maybe, you know. And but anyway, it was Tuesday and Thursday. At the end of Thursday, she said, I never imagined working in dental. I like this here. I'd like to give this a go. So that's what I would do. I would invite them in. And like I said, if you make this overture, if you make this, you compliment someone and they're not interested, now someone has your card. And maybe they'll be a patient in your practice. I mean, that's not a bad fallback. But I think there's a silver lining in looking outside of dentistry. Now, there are good people in dentistry that are looking at pivoting too. So right. I don't want to say, you know, be closed-minded. There are good people. There are good people that are looking for an office like yours. But I'd be open to looking outside of dentistry. We're going to talk a lot more about that in the Q&A segment. Training and all those details. But right now I want to put it on your radar screen. We have examples in my client base many. So this isn't just a unicorn kind of thing, but we have many examples of hiring from, you know, being creative about who we're looking for. And it's turned out to be a very intentional hire. And it's turned out to be someone that was really a great fit for the practice. All right, let's hit pause here on the coaching in action segment. And let's go to the Q&A segment where we can amplify and put more meat on the bone on how to do this.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment. This is Naren, your co-host. We had an awesome discussion with Gary today about hiring quality team members from outside of dentistry. And I have four questions to Gary, for Gary right now from all of you, where we go a little bit in depth. Gary, let me start with question number one. I like your idea of looking outside of dentistry for potential new team members. What is the best way to train these team members?
That's a great question. And I think you have to have your eyes wide open when you, when you're going this route and realize that when you hire someone outside of dentistry, they're going to need more training than if we just bring someone in that has past dental experience. Although keep in mind, when you bring someone in with past dental experience, does any of their past dental experience relate to the style of practice that you have? Possibly. It's entirely possible they could. They could have moved out of state from a really quality office and they're looking for a quality office as their new dental home. So it could be. But more often than not, the experience that they have is not really applicable to your practice because their style of practice they've been in the past is not like yours. And this is the mistake that I think a lot of offices make, dentists make when they hire someone. They assume that just because she has 10 years of experience, you can plug and play. Well, it might have been 10 years of experience in a Medicare office, Medicaid office. And if that was the case, it may not apply at all to yours. So in this case, you know you're going to have to provide some training because they don't have dental background. And you know there's really some great communities that can help with this. But before I talk about that, I want to talk about just onboarding. One of the concepts I like to use on onboarding is to borrow the term from the Greek sorority system of assigning your new hire a big sister, a big sister. Most of you know that I have four adult kids, one son and three daughters. Well, two of my three daughters were part of the Greek sorority system in college, and both of them had a very good experience with the Greek sorority system. So they were assigned when they were accepted to the sorority and in their orientation. They were assigned a big sister. The role of the big sister was to help them succeed in the sorority. So I would encourage you assigning your new hire a big sister. And the big sister's job is to help that new hire succeed in your practice, to fast track them to success. So think about that. And then as far as specific training, think about the position that they're hired in. For example, if you've hired an admin team member, administrative team member, I really like the association AADOM, ADOM. It's the American Association of Dental Office Managers. Now, the term office manager is a bit of a misnomer because it's not an exclusive domain for office managers. It's actually a domain for anyone that works in the business or administrative side of dentistry. So get your new team member a membership. It's very inexpensive. I want to say it's about $159 a year. There's all kinds of online resources in every different aspect of the business side of dentistry, the administrative side of dentistry. There's credentialing that your team member can get. She can become a FAADOM, an FAADOM, a fellow of the American Association of Dental Office Managers. There's two other more advanced levels of credentialing that she could do that would allow her to go through some education, some coursework, some testing to really demonstrate that she has mastery in those different areas. Now, one other thing we have to recognize is that that team member you hire from outside of dentistry won't have any experience with your practice management software. If you happen to have the same software we have at LifeSmiles, which is Open Dental, well, you're in luck because all of their training resources are available online. You can access that stuff as an Open Dental client through their portal. Dentrix and Eaglesoft have resources. However, they do it a little bit more the old-fashioned way, where they invite you to hire a trainer to come out in your office and do some training. I wish they would go a lot more virtual. Now, both Dentrix and Eaglesoft has some online training. Not quite sure how robust it is. But I do, if you have Dentrix, I have a very good resource to recommend. It was put together by a friend of mine, Dana Johnson. Dana's a brilliant Dentrix wizard. In fact, she was the number one Dentrix trainer for many, many years. And she decided to break away and create her own company. Her website, I'll spell it out for you, is, it's pronounced Novonee, Novonee.com, Novonee.com. Very inexpensive. And that resource provides you, anyone that would spend time on Novonee will become a Dentrix super user in no time. So there's some resources in mind. But before we finish this question, the other thing I would do is have your new hire from outside of dentistry shadow for a while. Have her shadow your hygienist. Have her shadow your assistants. Invite her into the treatment room. Of course, you have to have the right patient. It's not always appropriate to bring someone else in the treatment room. But whenever you have a patient that's open to that and you want to show her something in dentistry, and bring her into your treatment room and show her what you're doing. Say, hey, Linda, George was our patient today, and I replaced some old fillings today. This is what they look like before, and this is what they look like now. And I replaced them with modern material that do two things. They look very natural, and it strengthens the teeth. So anytime you have a chance to help educate her on the clinical side of dentistry, I would be all over that. Because that's what I think they're going to find a lot of passion around when they understand what a quality practitioner you are. Get ready for a little bit of a project, but it's a project that can really be worthwhile, especially if that ends up being, you know, her literally, you know, her job for life, and she's with you for many, many years.
Thank you, Gary.
That's,
I know you.
That's the goal we're looking for.
Right. I know you gave a really long, awesome explanation and tons of resources. Hopefully you benefit from these resources, Gary shared. Let me jump into question number two. You talked a little bit about where to find potential team members outside of dentistry in the coaching in action segment. Any other ideas of where we might find these people?
Well, you know, we talked in the coaching in action segment about just having your antenna out and talking to people that are doing their job well. And again, exactly. The line would be that, Maria, I noticed that you do your job very well. If you're ever thinking about changing careers, I own a dental practice in town, and I'd love to talk to you. If we look at more conventionally, the three most effective job boards that I've found in Esther for posting openings have been, and I would say it's this order. I would say Indeed, number one. Number two would be Dental Post, dentalpost.net. By the way, it's dentalpost.net. Number three would be ZipRecruiter. And then I said there'd be three, but maybe there's a fourth one, Craigslist. Now, Craigslist, be prepared to have to kiss a lot of frogs before you get a prince. And by that, I mean looking through resumes until you find someone that might be a potential candidate. But in any of those job boards, be sure to have language in your ad that invites. So if you're currently working in retail, working in a restaurant, a teacher, a counselor, a customer service representative, and interested in changing careers, we may have a perfect job opportunity for you. So call it out. You know, call out who you're looking for. And then in the ad, just say, we are willing to train the right person. So instead of the old ad, remember the old phrase?
Yeah.
20 years experience required. Instead of that,
right?
Go the other way. Say, we are absolutely willing to train the right person. And roll the welcome mat out.
Two things that I was just thinking, Gary, and based on our prior conversation as well. One is, I know in the coaching and action segment, you talked about specific industries. You talked about retail. You talked about banking. You talked about restaurants. But I'm just thinking, anyone you run into, typically, like, I mean, I remember sometimes going into a travel agent or an insurance, and there's this amazing person I run into, and like, I'm like, oh, I wish that person works for me.
And, those people stand out now because customer service is so poor everywhere.
Yeah.
But, you know, I went recently, I went into a physical Barnes and Noble store.
Yeah, I forgot about bookstores. Sometimes you get amazing people at bookstores.
Actually, the reason why I went in there is that my friend Paul Henney wrote the book Co-Discovery. Right. And I wanted to take a picture of the book in the store, you know, and send it to Paul. I knew he would really appreciate seeing his book, you know, his labor of love in the store. Yeah. So I went into the local Barnes and Noble store, and I asked the person at the help desk. I'm not sure this is a narrower topic book. It's for people in dentistry, and it's called Co-Discovery. It's written by Dr. Paul Henney. Are you carrying that? And she looked it up. She said, here, let me show you. Cause it might not be where you think it is. Her customer service was amazing. She walked me to the spot, to the bookshelf. Yeah. And then she's showing me, okay, here's how you look it up within here. And here it is. That was the kind of individual that I would have said, Nancy, if you are ever thinking about changing careers, cause I mean, how much longer is Barnes and Noble going to be around?
Aaron? I agree.
I mean, I agree. Really? I mean, obviously it's a bibliophile, it's a book lover, but someone that's a book lover might be kind of individual would be perfect in a dental office because they're interested in learning and probably pretty well versed on different things. And that's the kind of individual I would have asked.
The other thing I was just thinking is, Gary, I know you talked about, we have been doing things a certain way for a long time and we look inside the small pond where people who are looking for a dental job, right? The good thing about Indeed, for example, is it attracts people who are not just looking for dental jobs, but pretty much the whole, any kind of job. So that's a great place to, you know, customize your ad. So don't use a title with the word dental in it, right? For example, so it attracts people who are not just looking for dental.
Here's another good place. Go to your local community college. They'll likely have career counselors. Introduce yourself and tell them that if you have students that have a great personality and you think might be good at customer service, we're always looking for people like that. And let them know that.
You know, that's a great point. I know sometimes I get kids calling on us, right, in our house to do snow shoveling and stuff. And some of them run their own businesses and they're so organized. There's one girl, you know, she's, I guess, 19 or 20. She's on time every time. She will even call us and say, hey, there seems to be some snow today. Do you want us to come by? You know, like amazing. I'm like, if I had a job, I would hire in 2 seconds.
Perfect. Well, and also if there happens to be a college or university nearby, talk to the placement center at the university, especially in the liberal arts degrees. Right. Frankly, my degree is in history, my undergraduate degree is in history. Right. And talk to the, you know, the career counselors there, say, hey, if you have any sharp students that aren't quite sure what they want to do with this amazing degree they've earned from your university, we'd love to talk to them. And it might be a pathway to have someone kind of scouting for you to help you find the kind of person you're looking for.
Thank you, Gary. Let me go to question number 3. What have you found to be the most effective job board site to post an opening?
Well, we talked about that a little bit earlier, but let me just recap. So really 4 have been effective. Indeed, number one by far. Secondly, we talked about dentalpost.net. Now, dentalpost, you can actually post a job opening, but if you're an individual looking for a job, there's a segment on dentalpost.net. Like maybe someone's moving. Maybe they're moving from Connecticut to New York. And she knows she's going to be moving a high jumps maybe. And she knows she's going to be moving, you know, effective in March. She might put an ad herself, you know, she's an individual looking for an office. So go through those and see if you might find anyone there. So dentalpost.net, ZipRecruiter, which I'm going to, true confessions, I didn't know anything about. I knew it. Mm-hmm. I knew it existed. I knew it was a job board, but I didn't know if it was effective for dentistry until COVID. And it turns out that it's a fairly effective site.
Yeah, I think the thing about ZipRecruiter, at least what I heard, is it goes and scouts people for you. So in other words, it has all these relationships, all these links to lots of people. So they literally go and hunt.
Like, and characteristics that you're looking for, qualities.
Yeah, exactly. Sort of. Exactly. Yeah.
And then Craigslist. I think Craigslist is a bit of, you're kind of on a wild goose chase a little bit there, but you might find one, spend a little bit and have a team member, maybe your office manager or an admin team member, spend some time on Craigslist and see if anything jumps out. Anyone jumps out at you.
The other thing that we do, you know, we have 250 people in our company, is one of the problems with, you know, not being kissing the frog is you don't want to waste a lot of time with the frogs, right? Yeah. So let them do some work. So for example, you could ask them to send in a video. Why do you want, especially if they are like new to dentistry, why do you want to work in dentistry? Tell me a little bit about your experience. So you kind of see their personality, you kind of see who they are. So that way, you know, if it's not a good fit, or at least not making a great first impression, or even if they don't make the attempt, you know, they're not that passionate about this.
A comment about Indeed. You have to remember that Indeed, kind of over time, your ad gets pushed down. You want to repost fairly frequently, so it cycles back up to the top of the job board. It's not set it and forget it. You've got to manage that posting a little bit.
What about LinkedIn, Gary? I know we use it time to time for certain roles, and it seems to work.
LinkedIn is more typically for management level team members, executive level positions, but it could be also very useful in dentistry as well. So LinkedIn would be another place you could look. And that certainly gives you the opportunity to look and maybe discern the kind of characteristics and qualities and past experiences that you might be looking for.
Thank you, Gary. This is the last question I have for you. Question number four. I'm considering hiring a patient for a position in our practice. How can I set positive expectations right from the beginning? How can I do this in a way where it doesn't create any negative consequences?
Now, I was going to comment about another place to look is within your own practice in your patient base, but I knew this question was coming, so I knew I'd be covering it with this question. So first of all, hiring a patient could be an absolutely brilliant hire. I'm thinking of a client in our coaching base. It's a new client of ours, and I met the team in a team Zoom meeting, and doctor made a point when he introduced her to me. He said, "Gary, Susan, we found right here in our practice. She's been a patient of ours for a number of years. She's first of all the most wonderful patient I could ever ask for, and now even better, she's on my team. We hired her." And part of what it had happened was that Susan was in a career that she didn't especially love and was looking to do something different. And she loved this office because the dentistry that that was provided in the office was quite literally life-changing dentistry for her. It was cosmetic dentistry, gave her a gorgeous smile, and it changed her life, completely changed her. And so she was excited to be part of a team that was about changing people's lives. So that can be a great place to look. Now, remember that you're taking a risk when you hire someone like that. If it doesn't work out, then you run the risk of not only losing a team member, but losing a patient. So you really want to do your vetting. And you also want the expectations that I would have if her name was Susan, say, you know, Susan, at this point in time, I'm excited about you joining our team. And it sounds like you're excited about being part of the team. But if for some reason you discover that dentistry isn't for you, because can we agree that dentistry, clinical dentistry, is not for everybody? Would you agree, Gary?
Yes. Agreed.
Not for everybody. And if it's not for you, then I want you to feel very comfortable coming to me and letting me know that. Just say, no, you know, it just isn't for me. No harm, no foul. You know, I hope that this is something that you just feel like, oh my gosh, I just found my job for life. And I'm hoping we feel the same way about, oh, I've got my team member for life. That's our expectation of this. But if it doesn't work out, I want to just have open doors of communication, no judgment, nothing critical about that. So accept those expectations going in. But your patients, especially if they've had significant dentistry done, because now you've got a walking billboard in your practice that you can introduce to patients that say, you know, not only is Susan a team member of ours, but she's a patient of ours, and here's some things we've done for her. You know, that's a cool attribute to have, you know, as a team member. So absolutely, your patient base could be a great place to go. Maybe maybe a mother who has been a stay-at-home mom for a while, and now her kids are back in school and she wants to get back into the workforce. That could be a very good hire. Now, I will tell you this. So there was a time before I owned a practice where I felt like everybody needed to be full-time. You know, everyone needed to work full-time. I have completely changed my mind on that after owning a practice, because that doesn't work in everyone's, you know, work-home life. And if someone was only available 3 days a week, but they were a really good fit in our practice, I would absolutely consider hiring that person, because good people are not growing on trees. And I think we can be flexible with how hours that our team members work and so on. So food for thought. Well, this has been a fun episode. I hope I've shined a little bit of light on what has been a challenge. You know, our practice is really being fully staffed with our dream team. And I want you all to get back to that point. So I hope this podcast episode on hiring quality team members from outside of dentistry has served as some thought provoking and perhaps inspiration for you. As we wrap up today, just a quick reminder, coming up very shortly after publishing this episode is our next webinar, Seven Steps. I immediately think Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, right? Stephen Covey. This is Seven Steps for a Remarkable New Patient Experience. It's March 12th, 8 p.m. Eastern Time. Come join us, thrivingdentist.com/webinar. On that note, thank you for the privilege of your time. Naren and I look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.